Okay, so amongst a question about how you can get more, well, I think the question was how you can get more bliss and sort of tone down the energetic nature of someone who's quite energetic or enthusiastic. Well, the thing, you know, the one of the there's two core things with levels of consciousness, and especially if you're coming out from low levels of consciousness, or if you're coming off things like antidepressants or addiction, then there can be an extreme, because things like addiction and antidepressants, they really repress the feelings. So as soon as you stop doing those things, you can get an extreme overload of feelings coming up. And then this can be very agitating, create a lot of energy, create a lot of excitement, create a lot of stress, various things can come up. As all of these feelings that have been like kept under the hood, and now if you've been an overeater, if you've taken antidepressants, or if you've taken drugs, or if you take alcohol, or if you're just watching Netflix, you know, 24 hours a day, if you stop that and then replace it with another addiction or another thing to distract, a lot of things, feelings can come can come up. The thing I would, one of the things, the core things that I do is, a lot of this is due to repressed feelings coming up, and then depending on what belief systems are there in the ego, they become agitated, they become excitable. So whatever things are in the within the ego that the ego hooks into, those things tend to get very exaggerated. Also, you got to understand, like if when I was in food addiction, you know, like food is like a sort of a very sort of calming, knocks you out kind of thing. Depends what kind of food, but I would overdose on food. So I'd feel like I was kind of, it's like a suppressant, you know, you just feel like relaxed and lethargic. You don't have any excitement and you just sort of, you know, feel like you're blocked out. So, you know, when I stopped that, you know, huge feelings came up. In fact, panic attacks came up. I blew up with panic attacks and I had to go through those. And I think I've got some videos on going through those early panic attacks, which was like facing the death of the ego, because there was so, it's like a torrent of feelings and the ego doesn't want you, wants you to go back to what you were using before. And it was, make, you know, it was the feeling like you're going to die if you can't bear panic attacks, just go back to the food. But I knew that, you know, that's just the ego. And I have to transcend that by feeling that out to the other side until it passes. So the thing with the, all these feelings, one of the major tools I would use is learning, feeling the feelings, and sitting with the feelings. You know, like if I had a lot of feelings come up, in the early days, I would sometimes do feel the feelings for 4 hours straight. Like I would have gout attacks in my feet, excruciating pain. And I said, well, I'm just gonna sit with this horrific pain until it totally passes. And in the beginning, that would take about 4 hours. You know, eventually the sharp pain of the skin splitting and the horrific swelling. And then I'd sit with that and become more and more non-localized. And then eventually I'd go into, it would start to dissipate and become more and more diffuse. And then eventually I'd get into bliss. So that would take me 4 hours. And each time you're with these feelings, when you do feel the feelings, it's like you start to come down from whatever. If you're in fear, if you're in pain, if you're in agitation, if you're feeling very excited, as you start to feel the feelings, it depends how you feel it. If you can just feel it and just detach from whatever thoughts, trying to not hook into the thoughts and the story, then you'll eventually pull, all those feelings will start to get released and you'll start to feel serene, peaceful, chilled out. And eventually you can start to feel quite blissful, mellow and happy as you release. So each time you do that, you'll be releasing a lot of those feelings. Also be aware, you know, like sometimes, you know, when I've had, you know, when I've given up certain things I used to numb out, you'd get lots of negative feelings come up and you perceive the world through the filter of those emotions coming up. So if I suddenly like have lots and lots of fear coming up because I've stopped using whatever thing I'm using, then I might start feeling fearful or anxious or various feelings may come up. And just to remember that, you know, that becomes like a temporary filter from which you perceive the world. So you start to have fearful thoughts or anxious thoughts, and you start to see a fearful world. or an anxious world, depending on what flavor of feelings are coming up. But just to recognize that that's like a temporary thing until they pass, you're in a kind of an alternate world of perceiving fear and having fearful thoughts or anxious thoughts. And they may come up, or agitated thoughts or excited thoughts or excessive energy. You can also just sit out and feel out excessive energy and you'll start to calm down. And that's the right way. So feeling the feelings, the thing with like all the, you know, so that would be my prime tool. Now, if someone's feeling very excited or lots of energy and they want to do, you know, they're thinking 100 miles an hour, that's the last thing they want to do. They would probably want to run a marathon or just like do 100 things at the same time. But actually, it's the, as you learn to sit with the feelings, feel them out. Remember, these feelings, especially if you've stopped using something recently, they're finite. So if you just keep sitting with them, you'll go through a phase where it'll be quite unpleasant for a while, but eventually you start to chill out. And if you want to be like one of those chilled out, serene people, you just keep, every time a wave of extreme feelings comes, you just sit through it until you feel serene or peaceful or blissful or mellow. And then eventually, you know, things don't trigger you. You know, I mean, I'll give you an example, which is probably not a great example, but, you know, I used to love, when I gave up my food, you know, I'd like to buy things. You know, I'd like to go on Amazon and see, like, what can I buy to get that excitement? I'd have the urge, like, I need to buy something, you know. I mean, I like gadgets, looking at gadgets or looking at whatever it was on Amazon. That would be, you know, so it was fun. Then instead of doing that, like, I'd have the urge or I'd have the excitement or I'd have the, like, the thing. It's like I go, well, I'm going to sit. Every time I want to buy something, I won't do it. And I'll sit and feel that feeling out, that urge to want to buy something. And I always said to myself, after you felt it out, if the next day you want to buy it, you can buy it. So I'd always do that. And then, you know, after I felt it out, I didn't want to buy it. And then if the next day, I was sort of playing a game with myself, if the next day I still wanted to buy it, then I'd feel that out, and then I wouldn't want to buy it. After I felt it out, like you have the urge, and then you feel it out, and then you feel neutral. You don't feel like you need to buy it. It's like, what was I thinking about needing to buy that today? It was like, and then I'd do that. And then, you know, eventually it's like, you know, those urges don't come up. And it's like, and eventually I bought less and less stuff. It was quite funny. And, you know, my bank account went higher and higher. So that's the type of thing, whatever energy it is that starts to come up, if you sit with it until you calm down, and if it comes back up again, you sit the wave until it calms down, and then another wave, and then eventually these waves become less and less and less and less frequent, and eventually they stop. And that will be the same thing. So that's the key thing. In terms of, you know, that would be the number one mechanism I'd do if you wanted like a peaceful, blissful, serene person. Like every time you have extreme feelings, urges to do things, buy things, use things, whatever it is, or if you have like excitement. So here's the thing, because there's nothing in the world that is exciting. There's nothing in the world that is exciting to do. And I'll try and explain what I'm saying. Ultimately, when you're in, and I mean, I know there's lots of people in these rooms, when you're in a very high spiritual vibration, when there's these flow states, when you're in what's, you know, the eternal now, then everything is equally enjoyable. You know, it's just as enjoyable on a day in the flow or in the eternal now, just as enjoyable to walk in the park as it is to go to the toilet or brush your teeth. It's not like the events are enjoyable or there's something that's more exciting, you know. You don't get the thought like, if I do this thing in a few hours' time, I'll be more excited, so I can't wait to do that thing. Because you're in a constant high state, so you don't know, you know, you're in the present moment. So the thing to do something to get excited, you know, it doesn't happen unless you're in a lower level of consciousness, in which case the thoughts start to be activated. And because you're not in a high state, you have the thought, well, if I can do that activity later on, that's going to be exciting. Or, you know, so there is no such thing as, I mean, of course there is. If you're in a low state and you take cocaine, or if you're in a low vibration and you have a donut, of course you do notice that. But that's like you could say that's an illusory thing. That's because your ego is deflating and getting a spiritual connection by doing this activity and then projecting that a donut has the magical property to make you happy, or a relationship has the property to make you happy. Happy is an intrinsic state, you know, but it tends to get fluctuated through the ego mechanism. If there's certain thoughts, if you're coming off something, or if you're just agitated, another thing to do is just to transcend those things that make you excited or agitate you or do things. So, like, if I was to get very, very excited every time I think of a donut, or every time I see a donut, I get very, very excited, or I think I can't live my life without a donut, then, you know, I can start the work of transcendence. And, you know, of course, in miracles, various things, I think I've got quite a lot of videos out on there, but you want to get to a place where that becomes meaningless. So whether you see the thing, I mean, then, you know, if every single object and every single person and every single situation in the world was equal, was not more special, less special than anything else, then there would, you know, it's like you'd be living in the now. You know, you wouldn't be such a thing as like, well, everyone in this room is too boring for me, I want to go to another room where there's more exciting people. You know, that wouldn't come, because, you know, everything has been, you know, how the ego tracks, this is more special, this is less special, you're good, you're not good, all that framing of things and the future is all dissolved. So now you're in you're in those high spiritual states, you're in those flow states, you're in the eternal now, where it's not like an ego saying, well, I need to do something to get excited. Or there's not an ego. Also, when you go to high levels, you realize you do the spiritual work of what's called transcending attractions and aversions. Two major things with the ego. Like, the ego is like attracted to things, and the ego wants to run away from things. You know, like, I'm attracted to donuts, but I have an aversion to do my taxes. So you transcend those. If I have like, oh, I like, you know, it's free donuts going on, then I want to transcend that. That shouldn't really be a proper event within the ego. And also, doing the taxes shouldn't be something like I'm trying to run away and thinking like, this is like, oh, you know, there's a thing that's pulling my teeth. So, does that answer the question, or is there anything else?
Why do sometimes urges feel so incredibly strong, like they're taking hostage, literally, like you've got to do it right now?
I would like to answer that in two ways. One of them is, like, if you're working a spiritual program and you're starting to surrender your ego, as soon as you're surrendering an aspect of the ego where it's had dominion, and you're giving up something it gets a lot of ego juice out of, you'll often have like a huge battle, a huge confrontation with the ego, where it'll fight for dominance that you don't surrender the ground. So, like, when I gave up food, I started to have extreme panic attacks because I was living at such a low level of consciousness, disconnected so far from God, that the idea of giving that up would be a huge loss for the ego. So it suddenly was like a huge, extreme panic attacks, like you're going to die unless you go back to the donuts. So when you have a spiritual intention, you then have to have these battles. Where I knew from my teacher Hawkins that, you know, it's the ego saying you'll die if you go through this extreme feeling. And then you have to get the willingness or hear it from someone else, like hear it from me, that when those extreme feelings come, you know, it's safe to sit through them until they pass. Or even, you know, it's like don't buckle down, just pray, have the intention, and when those extreme feelings come, like you can't handle it, like be willing to sit through until it passes. In my case, I was willing to sit through the panic attack. I was willing to die from a panic attack. I should probably say that. It was so horrific, those panic attacks. It was like, you know, so I sort of said, okay, I'm willing to die, but I have faith in my teacher that this is the way to God. So I'd rather die than be under the master of these panic attacks. So I went through, and the first time I passed through one of these extreme things, that was more or less the start of 10 years of abstinence, you know, because it was like a major battle. You've got to understand, when these extreme feelings come, it's like a fight for dominance, like the ego saying, I'm going to show who's boss here. And it's like, I'm telling you, so when it's that extreme, you know, just pray for willingness and say, the next time this extreme thing happens, where it's going to like pull you by the scruff and make you act out in some way, just say, well, the next time that happens, I'm just going to sit in a chair. What I do, sit in a chair, hold it so you can't run off and do whatever it is you want to do. And just sit and try and be with that. You might get extreme thoughts about you're going to die or don't do it, or, you know, very, very extreme thoughts and extreme panic. But sit through it and be willing to die on that chair, but don't pick up until it totally passes.
Mm.
Yeah, are you with me?
Mm.
Do that. And the first time you do that, you should smash the ego. Because once you master a really extreme feeling without backing down, it's like a real dent to the ego. And I only had like 3 or 4 panic attacks after that first one. And they were easily handled because I knew I could do it. And then, you know, no more panic attacks for 10 years. So panic attacks were just an illusory mechanism the ego just used while it thought it had power.
Mm-hmm.
And once it knows it can't use that on you any longer, it stops doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And you've won. So, you know, whatever it is, just go through that. So the question was, if you're not doing spiritual work, you know, and you get grabbed by those things, it's because you've not got enough of a high spiritual connection. You all know that the higher spiritual level of consciousness, the more there is like an observing gap, a witnesser gap between your thoughts and thing, and eventually the thoughts don't become you. So, you know, if you're witnessing your thoughts and you become the detached witnesser of your thoughts, then even if a crazy thought came up, like, let's eat 100 chocolate cakes, you know, it's not going to grab you, you know. But when you're in the ego, lots of repressed feelings, and you are super identified with your thinking, it's like the thinking is you,
mm-hmm.
and you are orchestrated. So if a thought comes up and there's no spiritual connection, like, let's eat 100 chocolate cakes, you will eat the 100 chocolate cakes. Because you are the ego, you are super identified with your thoughts. So instruction comes, you do the instruction. As soon as you do spiritual work, there's a gap, there's a spiritual space. Eventually, as you get to the more enlightened states, as you witness, these thoughts hardly start to come, and then eventually the thoughts don't become you.
Mm-hmm.
It's something, you know, like you see a donut in the room or you see a chair in the room, they don't really have the power to orchestrate. It's more like you're being orchestrated by the universe rather than the thoughts orchestrating you. When you're in the ego, the thoughts orchestrate you. Whatever thoughts say, you do. When you're enlightened, the thoughts don't orchestrate you. Everything comes out of the universe spontaneously. But it's not being run by the thoughts, which is a different level of consciousness. Yeah?